They told him, Pastor, your wife is here. So he opened his eyes and called me. Then I answered, I began to ask him, do you want to leave me and these kids and go? That you should not do that. He asked me, where is he? I told him, Boromio Hospital. Said that I should take him out of this place if I love him. Or if I don't want him to die here, I should take him to his doctor at Oweri. As we were going, my husband called me that I should take care of the children and the ministry that he has built a house for me, that I should not worry, that I should take care of everything, that there are some people called to go quick, that is among them, that his journey is ended. And I began to cry now as a widow, and I began to recollect what I will suffer in future. So I was lamenting and crying. They were holding me that I should not cry. I know my condition, that I should hold myself.
When we get to Federal Medical Center, so time is late. They say they won't attend to us. So the doctor is not around. So one doctor and one nurse came out to come and check what happened. They say, we said that this man have an accident. He said, okay, there is no time. This man is already a dead man. We should take him to mortuary.
We rushed to this St. Eunice clinic and met Dr. Josie, the one we met up there. Then he thoroughly examined him and said he's off. That it's better we remove him and put him to the mortuary.
I was told he was involved in a motor accident at Onisha. When I examined him, I looked at the chest. There were no respiratory movements. I listened with the stethoscope. There were no breath sounds. I tried to look at the heart, the cardiovascular system. There were no heart sounds, and the patient had no pulse. I looked at the eyes. The pupils were fixed and dilated. I just made an impression right away that the patient was dead and he should be removed to the mortuary.
I don't know what to do again. My heart ran out of me. I was shouting. Hence their village is close to Oweri. I told them, let us run straight to their home and inform his father that his parents is at home. We proceeded to their hometown. Then when we reached there, his father came and joined us.
Then in the night, midnight of that Friday, the wife came here with the dead body. After seeing it, in order to avoid crowd of people, I took him with the wife to the mortuary.
When they brought him in here, he was being brought by the father and the wife. Then there's no life in him, no heartbeat, no any sign of breathlessness. They accepted him as a dead, as a corpse. Then after all those, I checked all around the body and everywhere is so stiff. That was what gave us the strength to start our procedure. When I sent him in to the second room, the last slab.
The mortuary man took our name. We gave him 1,000 naira to continue his work. Then on Saturday, I left here to Onisha again to bring home the children and the wife and my own first son that is living at Onisha. I brought all of them home here. As I brought them, we were here sleeping together before the wife cried.
But I began to call upon the name of the Lord. I began to remind God of his promises. And number one, this year God told me in Isaiah 61 that I shall not experience any violence in my home again, that I shall be called the city of the Lord. So when anything that happens, I will hold God on that word. I say, this is one of the violence. It has come again, and you promised me that I will not experience them again. Why this one? So that is always motivate me to hold God firm so that violence will disappear from my way. And this another verse that always appears to me is Hebrews 11:35. Women receive their dead bodies to life. So the moment I read this place, it always put force in me to hold God and act. So that night, when I remembered all these things, I said, no, it cannot happen. I must do something to prove God again.
On Saturday, while we were sleeping in the night, the wife of my son, for I took him to the mortuary. He said, the woman said that the husband is disturbing her, that they should carry her to Onisha for Reverend Bonnke.
After some time, my father-in-law considered, then both of us, he went to them and planned with them. Before I could come, they have already put my husband inside the gasket, and I was with my first son, Victor. So when we reached there, I hide inside somewhere so that he will not see the father, because as he was questioning me, where is my daddy? I told him, your daddy is in the village. When we reached the village, he asked me, where is his daddy? I told him, he's at Onisha. So I was deceiving the little boy, and he was crying. So the moment they put him inside the ambulance, they pushed me. I ran inside the car, with the front side, with my son and with his brother. So we started coming down to this place. When we reached at the GRA, I saw somebody. I asked them, do you know if Bonnke has come?
Bonnke was here on the second day of December 2001 to commission the Kingdom Light World Evangelism, which is the evangelistic arm of this great ministry. We put out the advert. We even invited people to come that is going to pray for the sick and is going to pray for the Onisha people. Then we're on the platform around 1 p.m. Bonnke was preaching. Suddenly somebody came to me and they told me that they brought a man with an ambulance, a coffin.
Both of us were sitting together at the same place inside the church before an usher quickly ran in and told us there's an emergency. They are trying to bring in a corpse into the church, and we have to run down from the fourth floor down to this place. And coming down here, we met an ambulance car. Already a pastor has already ordered them to go up. And we told the ambulance people to come down here. And I told them, first of all, go and bring the man's wife. I would like to talk with her first. And they now brought her over, and we were just down there at the shade. I was asking her what actually happened.
I felt that the anointing will be so high here, that the anointing will resurrect my husband. That was what I felt before coming down here.
Both of us, we consulted together. I told him that it would be a very big embarrassment bringing a corpse inside the church. And what do we do that wherever we are, that God is, that if God wants to perform a miracle for the man, the place where the man is does not really matter.
Then the security men, because we have security men from the state government and the federal government, the SS people, the mobile police unit, they were there, they ordered the ambulance to stop. And demanded that they will open the casket to make sure that they didn't bring in bomb, telling people that it's a dead person. When they looked at him, it was a coffin, it was a dead person. They ordered them to close the casket. Then that was the time our local security men told them to move away with the coffin. Then the wife started crying and said, I believe that he's going to come back to life. I believe, when she started crying, and they were arguing. Some people said, bring him down. Some people said, no. Then some of my people will bring it down. Other people will push it back. Some people, will, and they were dragging until my son went there and told them to carry him to the basement and to get him out of the coffin, that they should not carry it with the coffin into the basement because the children will be scared and people will run away.
First of all, they should remove him from the casket, which some other boys helped us do. They removed him from the casket down there, just at this plane now. And we quickly have to run inside this, inside the youth conference center. We are looking for a place to lay him, and they brought in these two tables, and his head was here while his legs were here. This was the first place where they now laid him.
Then we come to the meeting. Bonnke finished. He prayed for people. After praying for the people, I took him to the office. Somebody rushed in and said, it's now breathing, that is breathing, he's breathing.
Now he has started breathing bit by bit, that we should pray. So I and my pastor friend, Pastor Luke Ibekwe, we started praying. But when I touched him from the head to the toe, was like a stockfish. And his hands like this. Even there are some people that snapped in a picture. His hands were like this, by the sides. I just lying like that. So we started praying. We continued praying and praying and praying. He was breathing, his breath was reviving and reviving and reviving until some other person go and gathered our boys inside the main auditorium. When they gathered them, they all gathered here. We were all praying. At times I would say, stop, let us sing. And we sing and we pray. People were all around this place. They wanted to see. They wanted to know what finally happened. So we were praying all through. As we were praying, we were even sweating. And we were telling people to go away that he will get some this thing. And the wife was sitting down there in a bench. So, and we were just praying and praying. So as we were praying now, suddenly we saw the eyes started, life started coming in. I said to my pastor friend, Pastor Luke, that you know they say that he had been in 3 days in the mortuary. Let us massage him. So he was there massaging the right hand, and I was here massaging the left hand. We are that squeezing it, making sure that life, because now we find out that as we are praying, that the heart started, the heart become hot. So, and he was breathing. We started massaging the hands. As we massaged the hands, suddenly it seemed that life came into the hands, and we put the hands on the heart and the chest. Now, the neck, I massaged the neck, and life came into it. I was able to turn it, but before it was like a stockfish. I was able to turn it.
I picked up the mic and announced to the whole people that dead man they brought here is now breathing. And the father interrupted my announcement and said, although he's breathing, his body is still like iron.
Suddenly, people shouted for me to turn to see why people are shouting, because they were all there, filled up all this place. They want to see. And when they shouted, I saw this man jumped up. When he jumped up, I abandoned the person I was with. And I rushed and I grabbed him just like this.
When he started breathing, suddenly he jumped up. One of the men in deliverance grabbed him. Then he looked around. Then they decided to carry him up because people were jamming into the place. Then he asked for his fire.
I find out that if we keep him here, people may trample upon us. I say, let us take him upstairs. And we follow through the step, staircase there. And we go at the edge of the step. He say, water. He demanded for water. I was shouting, bring water. Let's give him water. And as they were delaying, he was asking me, my file. And I said, that is the fire the enemy is using to accuse you. Just cool it, you will understand. As we carried him to the pastor of priest's office under the fan, we keep him there, and the fan was rolling. He was still asking, where is my file? You see, and after which, mommy come in there. He said, the air is too compacted, that we should take him to the main auditorium, that he will have enough air. So we take him to the main auditorium, people throng. Suddenly we saw people coming in from the outside. It seemed that a noose went in and people started coming in. As people were coming in there, they saw the same man sitting down.
I went back to my village with a ram. I gave it to my father, and I told him I'll be coming back with bags of rice because of the Christmas. So on my way coming back, getting to my house, there's a very big valley. The valley is very, very much. So on my way getting to that place, the brake of my car failed. I missed this car, 238. So I tried to control the car, I couldn't. And because of how dangerous that place is, there's a very big pillars they positioned there to wedge a car not to somersault inside the big place. So my car had to hit those pillars, and I hit my chest on the steering. And I remembered I was vomiting blood. Blood was coming out of my nose. So, and there was someone with me. He was also wounded. So people crowded. I remember they brought me out of the steering. That was all I could remember. While I was at the hospital, immediately I got myself. I just looked around and saw all the drips and all the things they fixed on me. So I now requested for my wife. And when they brought her, I told her that I want them to take me to Dr. Omezurike at Owerri, because he has been my doctor. There was a time I was slaughtered. He was the one that took care of me. So I now requested that they should take me to him.
Then we took him out from that place. Off we went to Owerri.
I had pastors and other people to go with me. So, but because of the way I was breathing, so I felt within me that something might happen on the way. I now requested that they should please allow my wife to come in. So I and my wife was in the ambulance. So at the time, two angels came inside the ambulance. Immediately I saw them, I was afraid. I wanted to say it out what I saw. But eventually, one of them just shut me up. So I couldn't talk concerning the angels. But I only told my wife, take care of the church, this and that, and things that she don't know. When the two angels took me off, so we came to a place that they now handed me over to an angel, one of them. So that one now took me to a place. He told me that we are going to visit paradise. That was what he told me. Because I was communicating with him as human being, everything you can. I asked him questions, he answered my questions. He was holding me like a friend. So he now told me that we're going to visit paradise. So we now visited a place. When we approached the place, I saw multitude of people that look exactly like the one with me, that angel with me. The angel with me was having a white apparel. The body was pure white. The apparel was pure white, but the apparel doesn't look removable from the body. So, and when I saw this crowd, they were looking exactly like the one with me. So in my heart, I said, oh, look at where the angels gathered. That was what I thought, because I was still having thought in me there. So now he told me that this is where the saints that had died, this is where they are. So while I watched them, they were singing praises and so wonderfully, you know, it was as if there was a force inside that environment that controls what they do. When they want to raise their hand, they raise it at once. No one will be faster, no one will be late. If they want to bow down, they will just go down. Wow, no one will be faster, no one will be late, as if there's a force controlling them doing other things. Was hearing a lot of musical instruments, but I never see anyone. So while that experience was going on, in my spirit, I desired it most to go in there to join them. I even made a move. He said, no, I still have a lot of things to show you. Don't go in. So after that, he now said, let us go and visit the mansion Jesus promised. Are you getting what I'm saying? He now took me to a wonderful place. In fact, what I saw there, I don't have anything to describe it. It was so glorious, very wonderful mansion. You look at the building, you look like glass, look like gold, look like whatever. Even the flowers there, we are looking like gold. So, you know, when I was looking at that place, he now told me that Jesus has finished the mansions, but the saints are not ready. He now said, now let us visit hell. That was the last distance. Now, that's one thing that happens. From the paradise, whatever he said, we appear to the place. We never fly, we never move. Immediately he said, let us visit the mansion. In a twinkle of an eye, I just found a place that looked like that mansion. So from that mansion, he now said, let us visit hell. In a twinkle of an eye, we found ourselves the place. So immediately we approached the place. That gate was so big, so large. They wrote on top of it, welcome to the gate of hell. As soon as we got to the place, the angel just raised his hand like this, waved it down, and the gate opened with a wonderful noise. So immediately the noise the gate opened, I started hearing lamentations. So I now looked inside, I saw people like us here. They were having the same, they were putting on some clothes, the same flesh, some are black, some are white. They just look like us outside what I saw in the other side. So they were shouting, there was a lot of pains, a lot of torment, to the extent that immediately that gate was open. It was as if they were seeing me. And I don't even think that they were seeing the angel with me, because I was standing with the angel, because they never asked the angel to help them. They was asking me for help, shouting, and I remembered one wonderful one, because I'm a pastor, so that one touched me so much. He was shouting that I'm a pastor, I only ate church money, that I'm ready to refund. Immediately he just wanted to say, I'm ready to refund it, that I should help. That force that we are tormenting, I never see any fire there, I never see any flame here. But the torment there looks as if people, that they are inside fire. All these things the angel was telling me, I was writing them down in a file. The angel gave me a file and a pen. I was jotting all of them down. Even when I walk here, I remember that was the first thing I remember, that file. I asked them, where is my file? They couldn't understand me. So all those things I saw, I jotted them down, but it was later I realized that the file might be my memories and all that. So while I was shouting, asking him for help, he said, that I have another chance to go back. He mentioned this, that the request of the rich man in hell had been granted to this generation. I didn't understand it. It was now that I woke up, I read the Bible, I realized that the request was, the rich man was requesting that a dead man should be sent back to the world. So he just said that the request of the rich man had been granted to this generation for the last warning. He said to me that he's giving me opportunity to go back for the last warning to this generation.
How are you?
It was on the 30th of November, that was a Friday night. Then he was being brought here by the father and the wife, then with a red Volvo ambulance. Then when I handed over, they handed me over the corpse, we lay him down here for first examination. Then when they left, I filled the forms, every necessary arrangements, I gave them the tally as normal procedure, and they left. All right, this is the mortuary. And this is room 2. This is where we laid him. On top of this slab is where we laid him. That very night. So this is the coffin where he was being put. Over from here to Onisha. Where he was being raised again. These are the piece of cutting wood that we use to close your stockings. Stockings for your leg and the hand gloves that we use to close your and during the day. That was the day I fell for Sunday. This is where we was being laid down all the way from here to Onisha. So on the first thing, Sunday morning, your wife came down and cried to me, told me that there's a man of God in town, an evangelist, Rienhard Bonnke.
Well, it's shocking. Seeing a dead man, somebody that was once dead, is now alive. It's very shocking. And again, looking at the person and almost discussing with him. To God, all glory should go.
Up to now, I'm still afraid of him because the experience I saw on Friday and what I'm seeing here today, I think we should give God thanks because I can't believe it. I can't believe it myself.
But that time on Monday when he came to my house, he was smelling chemical. He was smelling chemical all over him. You see, but now, I haven't seen such a thing. I know that dead people can be raised to life, but I've never heard of people, somebody, who have been 3 days in the mortuary. It was a security man that removed the cotton wool in his nose, untied everything in his hand. It was too much. It's mind-boggling.
When the angels took me from the ambulance, I knew within me that these are angels, because I'm a Christian. I've been having those stories and all those things. So when I saw them, I knew that they are angels. So I knew within me that this is death. That was where I stopped knowing anything. I didn't remember my wife, my children, my houses and my cars, everything about me, because somehow God blessed me. But I didn't remember any one of them. And again, on that Sunday, when I woke up, so I was hearing a lot of voices. When I saw some hands holding me, this one was saying coffin, mortuary, 3 days. I couldn't understand. I didn't ask any question until when we got to the house. My wife now detailed me. Anyway, I told my wife that starting from this moment, as long as this heavenly race is concerned, if I hear, hey, I will lock myself in a toilet. When the noise is stopped, I will come out because I'm not ready to miss this heaven. That's what I told her. Because I'm not ready for any other problem. That's what I told her. It affected me that I became more afraid of God.
When they brought him into this hall, a lame woman with crutches saw him, threw off her crutches, not walking, she started running. I could remember the reaction of the man whose husband walked, whose wife walked. When the wife started running about, he wanted to embrace the husband said, don't touch me, I'm a sinner. I'm a sinner, I've been committing sin. If you touch me, you may be crippled again. And the man rushed to the altar and raised his hand and started crying, asking God to forgive for all his sins. It was terrible here.
There's a battle in the heartland where my faith and real life will be. Sometimes hope seems out of reach. I hear the growing cry for freedom. Am I equal to the call? Where's the love that conquers all? It's so easy to be human, so human to give in. But when I reach beyond my weakness, I'm reminded once again, the power is still where the storm breaks where it's always been. Where's the passion for the mission? Where's the fervor of our faith? Where's the evidence of grace? Where's the love? Of human need. Where's the truth that sets men free? In a world that holds no answer, every heart will someday find that everything they've lost.
My friends, what you have just seen is a miracle that was witnessed and documented to such an extent that I believe no one can walk away from it casually. Daniel's wife, Neka, acted on her stubborn faith in the miracle power of Jesus, and without her faith and corresponding actions, none of the preceding events would have taken place. But there is more to this than the importance of faith. It is clear that the Lord has something very specific to say to this generation, to all of us. In the over 30 years that I have preached across Africa, I have preached on the rich man and Lazarus countless times. Since it closely relates to what you have just seen and heard, I would like to show you a brief excerpt from this message. I will be right back.
Now the question in my mind is this. What was the damning sin which that man committed that made him go to hell? How many of you want to know too? I knew it, that's why I'm preaching this message. I'm going to tell you crystal clear what the damning sin of that man was, so that nobody here repeats it. Luke 16 verse 19 says that he was a rich man when he was on earth. I asked myself, can it be that that man went to hell because he was rich? What do you think? Yes or no? No.
No.
I agree with you. The rich man didn't go to hell because he was rich, and the poor man didn't go to heaven because he was poor. In one night, the rich man died in the palace and the poor man died outside the palace. When the rich man closed his eyes on earth, the next split second, he opened his eyes in hell. This is Jesus speaking. This is Jesus speaking. Amen. The rich man died, and the next moment he was in hell. Then Jesus said, the poor man died and was carried by the angels into Abraham's bosom, the place of comfort, paradise, heaven, call it what you want. It was the place of eternity, of joy and of comfort. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Now, by a miracle, I suppose, when that man was in hell, by a miracle, he looked up and he couldn't believe his eyes, he could see right into heaven.
Hey.
Amen. And he saw that poor man who was in front of his house, he saw him in the arms of Abraham. Now a conversation started between hell and heaven, and that will give us the answer to the question what the damning sin of the man in hell was. Say amen. Hallelujah. The rich man in hell screamed and said, he said, Father Abraham, send Lazarus with one drop of water here down to hell, because I am tormented in these flames. Abraham said, this is not possible because there is no bridge from heaven to hell. Nobody can come up and nobody will go down. When the man in hell realized that he couldn't get help from heaven while he was in hell, when he realized that, then he said, Father Abraham, I beg you, I still have got five brothers on earth who commit the very same sin that I have committed, which means that they will come and join me in hell. Please let somebody rise from the dead and go home to my brothers' houses and knock on their door and say, greetings from your brother in hell. You need to be saved by Jesus. Hey. What did Abraham say? Abraham said, they have Moses and the prophets. He meant they have the word of God and they have the preachers of the word of God.
And if they don't believe the word of God by the preachers of the word of God, they will also not believe if somebody would return from the dead. Say amen. Now I come to the point. Now I'm ready to tell you what I believe was the damning sin that made that man go to hell. In verse 30, the rich man screamed from hell to heaven. In reply and said, "No, Father Abraham. No, 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 Father Abraham." Suddenly the Holy Spirit began to speak to me. And he said, "Here you can see what the sin of this man was that made him go to hell." Are you listening? This is it. That man in hell said no to Abraham in death. But before in his life, he had said no to Jesus. And a no to Jesus is the worst sin a human being can commit. Here this evening, I stand here as a servant of the Most High God. And I am going to cry that name out one more time. And as I will cry it out together with you, I pray that the Holy Spirit may burn it with fire into your heart. That you may never, 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 never forget it. It is the wonderful name. It is the matchless name. It is the glorious name. It is the name above all names. It is the name of Jesus. My dear friend, I want to repeat one thing from what you just heard. When Abraham answered the rich man's request, he said, "They have Moses and the prophets. Let them hear them." In other words, we could say in our day and age that they have the word of God. Let them hear it and be saved. Then the rich man shouted, "No, Father Abraham." These were telling words. He obviously did not think that his brothers would regard the word of the Lord, the horrible mistake he himself had made. My friend, do not make the same mistake of the rich man and disregard the word of God. I am pleading with you. You have seen a sign from heaven, but its function is to lead you to the living Savior and lover of your soul, Jesus Christ.
He is the one who shed his blood for you. And the word of God says, whosoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. That name is the name of Jesus. I'm inviting you to take this vital step this very moment. If I could, I would want to put my arm around you and lead you to this wonderful, wonderful, and only Savior from sin and hell, Jesus Christ. Let's call upon his name this moment, and then that very second, something happens inside of you, as it also happened inside of me, because Jesus Christ enters your life. Just repeat this prayer after me, but from the bottom of your heart and with trust and commitment, and heaven will not be silent. There will come a reply. Shall we pray? Let's pray and repeat these words after me. Dear Lord Jesus Christ, I have heard your word and respond to your invitation. I say yes to Jesus. I say yes to salvation. And I say no to sin and Satan. I repent of my sin. I commit my life to you. I believe with my heart what I now speak with my mouth, that I am a child of God, that Jesus Christ is my Savior. I am born again. I believe it and I receive it, and I thank you for it. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Accept it, appropriate it by faith, that you are now a child of God, and that you are, as of this moment, on your way to heaven. God bless you.
Jesus Christ, the Son of God, we are sinners and come short of the glory of God. Those that came here with bondage, here with curses, here with sins, here with uncleanness, here with addiction, you will walk home totally free with the peace of God.
Dear friends, there are times in life when you just stand in awe of what God is doing by His Holy Spirit right in front of your very eyes. Our Millennium Crusade in Lagos, Nigeria turned out to be one of these experiences for me. I received a prophecy many years ago that I would one day see a million souls saved in a single service, and on the final night, this came to pass. The decision card count from that day was 1,093,745. The testimonies of salvation, deliverance, and miraculous healings were too numerous to count.
As he began to pray, I believe God that God will move down to wherever the specimens are and cause them to be negative.
Be healed from tuberculosis! In the name of Jesus!
I believe God. So he prayed and then he said, tuberculosis be healed in Jesus' name. So I said, amen, case dismissed. AFB, not seen.
Yahweh Rapha.
Throughout the week, we received a total of 3.4 million decision cards. To God be the glory. We also held our fire conference for pastors and church workers in the National Stadium, and over 80,000 gathered to receive their flame of fire in order to go out and effectively fulfill the Great Commission.
Jesus does not call us because of what we are, but because of what he makes from us. Jesus chose ordinary people. People like me and people like you.
I was a sinner. I used to go to church, but I've not submitted my life to Christ. But when I came to the crusade yesterday, when he was preaching from the book of John, he said, by the blood of Jesus, by the power of the blood of Jesus, from there the Spirit touches me, and I give my life to Christ now as my personal Savior.
Perfect Lamb of God! He came to save sinners.